Coach Dave Miller, another season of Fairmont Firebirds football. And I presume this one's not going to be any easier than the last. Time will tell.
Never are.
A Thursday tradition has been to open the season against Alter. Do you like that, or does it really matter?
I like it. I think, you know, number one, it's early, you know, because a lot of people are going on Friday. So it's kind of one of the few games in town that are going on. So, you know, we usually get a really big crowd. It starts the school year off. I mean, for our community, I can't think of a better way to do it. For our kids to be able to play in an environment like that is pretty unique. So, yeah, I think it's pretty special.
Okay, let's start with the running back position. How and with whom do you replace Drew Baker, who had 135 yards last year?
Well, it's hard to replace Drew Baker. You know, that people have asked that question over and over again. What you have to do is, you know, we have Justin Turner, who was our JV fullback last year. So far, he's been the guy, you know, kind of to surface in our last scrimmage. Had a pretty good scrimmage. You know, we have Damian Patton, a freshman. He's going to be a really good football player. He's been sprinkled in there a little bit. And then there are some other guys that we have in the mix. So I think this year at this point, it's still an unknown, but it could be by committee. It just depends on really how things progress, because there's a lot of guys, you know, that we're working in there. So we'll see how it goes.
Okay. Is Brock Baker, who had more than 600 total yards last year, entrenched at quarterback in his junior year?
Yeah, he right now he's our starter. Had a pretty good scrimmage himself. As a returning starter, you know, midway through the year, his first start was against Springfield. We went up there and you know, he did a really good job that night. So, you know, he brings some experience, which is important. And then we have, you know, two guys behind him right now. J.J. Hill has done an outstanding job. Zach Gegel also sprinkles in there a little bit. Kind of running back and halfback and quarterback. And then, you know, freshman Gabe Perry's has been working in there too. So I feel like we have, you know, solid quarterbacks, you know, beginning with Brock.
Who are the players to look for at the wide receiver position?
Well, we return really, you know, our three primary guys. You know, Carson Copley got some time early. You know, midway through the year, we kind of transitioned a little bit, brought some defensive guys over. Stevie Doty and Logan Wilkins are both going to be in there too. But Carson, between those three, you know, right now, they'll probably take most of the snaps. Tony Bruno has really stepped up. He's had a really good summer. And, you know, I'd put Zach Maley in there too. You know, so those are two young guys that are competing for that spot. And lately we've had Troy Engelman, who came back out, you know, so all those guys are juniors. So looks pretty good there. We've had a really good summer, like I said, and put a lot more emphasis on that. So that's good to see.
All right. Let's go to the offensive line. Who are the returnees and who are the potential newcomers?
Well, right now we have, you know, with experience, Colton Green was our really only starter last year, but Noah Tulloch pretty quickly established himself, I think by week two or three. So really those two guys are our returning starters. Aiden Stringer, all three of those guys are seniors. Stringer got some, you know, valuable experience last year, even though he wasn't a starter. And then, you know, we have a lot of new faces in there right now battling for the other positions. Right now, kind of the front runners are Taven Gifford Jr. And Junior Brett Fuller. But we also have Jonathan Gwizdak and, you know, some other guys there too. Luke Young as sophomores. Griffin Cromick's another guy I'd probably go mention there too. So, you know, all those guys are kind of working in there.
All right. Will Hoyt, he was quite a weapon as a kicker last year, but he's graduated. Now who doesn't?
Well, right now it's Max Gehring, and Max was, you know, kind of Will's understudy, so to speak. But and Max has a very strong leg, a lot of potential. You know, Coach Gantz has worked hard on fine-tuning some things with him. And, you know, this past week has been pretty big. He had an outstanding scrimmage. That was kind of a bright spot. So I think there's big things on the horizon for him. He's a junior. And like I said, his leg strength is really phenomenal. So if we can get him locked in, you know, we had a scrimmage the other day and he missed a 49-yarder just wide left, and he cleared that thing by like 5 yards. So the strength is there. We just have to, you know, refine it. So
All right, and finally, can you summarize the defense? Who are the top returnees and who should shine?
Well, you know, our two corners are back, Stevie Doty and Cameron Payne, kind of locking those down right now. Linebacker-wise, we have Gavin Prophet, who's back from last year, started as a sophomore. Stevie and Cameron are both seniors. Up front, you know, it's primarily returning-wise, it's Devin Porter. You know, and then it's a lot of new faces. There's a lot of talent, but we have to quickly kind of figure out who can play, and there's a lot of things that we have to correct from the scrimmage the other day. But we have an excellent defensive staff led by Steve McDonald, our D coordinator. Those guys are outstanding, you know, so I have complete faith that they're going to get things fixed, you know, and we have to do it in a hurry. But, you know, and like I said, there's a lot of talent there. You know, Daniel Seaton, a senior that came back out, he's working at strong safety right now. Kind of took 2 years off, which you don't want to see, but I'm glad he came back out. Right now, Toby Deglo is working in at free safety as a junior. Then there's a slew of linebackers. I mean, I can't even name them all, but they're all battling in there. Logan Wilkins and Connor Haston as juniors on our D-line. And then, you know, hopefully we get Levi Allen back. He's kind of fought an illness back in June and still hasn't really come back yet. So, you know, we'll see.
All right, Coach. Well, I want to thank you for your time and giving us a little preview of the team. And I want to wish you good luck on the 17th.
Thank you. Thanks. Appreciate it, Norm.
I'm with Coach Ed Domsites. He's the head coach of the Alter Knights, who will be taking on the Fairmont Firebirds here. So, Coach, a Thursday tradition is playing Fairmont. Do you like that, or would you rather play a week or two later?
No, I like that. I like opening up against Fairmont, especially when it's on Thursday. It's usually a day before most teams get started, so we get a great audience. I think it really sets the tone for the school year. With kids up, kids paint themselves up. They fill the stands on both sides, and it's a great time. I like being the first week.
Okay, what is the quarterback situation? Is it in the hands of junior Gavin Connor, who combined for 1,700 yards last year? And what improvement would you like to see in him?
Well, yeah, Gavin, I think he's the starter. I think with the experience that he's had, I think we saw improvement last year. I think, yes, there's always opportunities to get better. And I think in Gavin's case, judgment, which is always subject to some kind of improvement by any quarterback. Judgment in terms of when to throw, who to throw to. I'd like to see him reading his progressions, particularly when we're in the shotgun, going through the progressions and throwing to the open receiver. I think he runs the ball well. He's doing a nice job reading the option. So there are a lot of things that, with his experience, that he does well.
All right. Can you assess the wideout position? It seems like the top two are Sheets and Russ.
Russ. Yeah. Yeah, I think those are two. We're blessed at the wideout spot. We've got probably four or five. You've got Andy Duplain along with Michael Russ and Carter Sheets. With them, you've got Jimmy Nagel, you've got John Tiemann, Channing Hawes has much improved. So we're like I say, we're blessed at that wide receiver spot. All those kids can run. They run nice routes. Duplain, Tiemann, probably two best route runners. But all of them can catch. They can catch in a crowd, and they provide good targets.
Who will your top rushers be?
Well, you know, it's when you run the option, for example, it comes down to what's open from game to game, play to play. But it should be our running backs. It would we've got two with experience, Noah Jones and Rod Owens, and both are very capable. Christian Woods is a junior, and Christian has shown a great deal of improvement, much stronger than he was a year ago. So those are the three. Those are three who should be right up there at the top. And fullback should pick up. Hopefully there are about three who are going to share the fullback duties. They should get an ample amount of yardage.
How about the offensive line? How experienced is it?
It's looking pretty good at this point. We don't have depth. Depth is always going to be a problem at a Division IV school. That's one of the things that we're looking at to try to come up with answers for this year. Offensive lines led by Jake Noga, and Jackson Wright, two of our seniors.
Who are some of the key figures on defense, starting with senior linebacker Henry Reifschneider?
Yeah, Henry Reifschneider.
Reifschneider, and with 118 tackles last year.
Yeah, I think you can start in the middle with Henry, and he's big. I mean, in terms of his ability, he likes to hit. I think with the experience that he had last year, he's going to be all that much better. When you ask who are the, you go over it, and oftentimes you look at your seniors in the secondary. We've got Michael Russ, we got Colin Wayner, Sheets will be back there, Duplain will be back there. When I start naming them, I always end up missing a few. But many of these kids who are out there playing right now are still going to be sophomores and juniors, and much of the defense, we can see that on much of the defense.
All right, final question. Who will handle the place kicking, kickoffs, and punting?
Well, I'd say the place kicking is probably going to be handled for the most part by our senior, Tony R. Curry. And the punting should be Colin Wayner. And that's both of them are seniors, so that's good that we get to mention them. I think we have a sophomore place kicker who's coming along, but it's still probably our Curry right now.
All right, Coach. Well, thank you for taking the time to speak with me today, and good luck on the 17th.
Thank you.
Hello and welcome inside Roush Stadium as we get ready to kick off the 2023 MVCC Game of the Week. Jared Bergstrom alongside Andy Horton, and we welcome you to the 56th meeting of the Battle of Kettering between the Alter Knights and the Fairmont Firebirds. Andy, real quick, a player to watch for Alter.
Well, Jared, I think a player to watch for Alter. You don't normally see me going for defensive players, but I think I got to go for Henry Reifschneider, who is their leading tackler from last season. The guy's an absolute monster. 118 tackles, 75 solo, and 11 tackles for loss. He's all over the field for the Alter Knights. Jared, who's a guy to watch for the Firebirds?
I gotta pick number one, Cameron Payne for the Firebirds on defense. We saw him last year. He blocked that field goal in the Alter game that gave the Firebirds some momentum. He returned and opened the opening kickoff in our Springboro game. He had two interceptions against Miamisburg. The kid is all over the field. He's one of the fastest kids in GWAC. Went to state last year for track, and definitely going to be one to watch this tonight and the rest of the year for the Firebirds. Andy, you want to make a prediction? I know we really don't start till tomorrow when we got Miamisburg and West Carrollton, but want to make a prediction for tonight's game?
Well, I would tell you to make your pick first, but I think everyone knows.
I think anybody listening and watching knows that
followed you throughout your career knows who you're picking.
Yes,
this is a tough one for me. I really, I like what the Firebirds have done over the last couple years. We talked to Coach, and he talked to other people throughout the offseason saying that it's looking like they might open the offense up a little bit more this year, throw the ball a little bit more, and that excites me. I love the offense that the Firebirds run. It's just If I was the coach, I might throw the ball a couple more times. So that makes me really excited to see. But then you also have an alter quarterback, you know, who's going to come back, and he's going to be in his third starting season. Last year he was efficient, had 19 total touchdowns to 10 interceptions, completed 53% of his passes. So it's a tough decision, and you know, I think I've stalled long enough. I guess I'm going to go with the Firebirds.
Okay. As that opening kickoff was booted out of the back of the end zone, so we're going to see the Alter Knights and Gavin Connor take over at the 20-yard line. Now, this is going to be the test we're going to see from the Firebirds here early on this first possession. How are you going to replace Enoch Cruz, Dalton Gusweiler, Aiden Penix, Owen Olsen? I just listed like the top seven tacklers from last year. Owen Russell, another one. How are the Firebirds going to start with this first possession on defense here to start the season?
Especially in a situation where, you know, the Alter Knights, they have a lot of starters returning on both sides of the ball, you know, especially along the offensive line. They got starting center who's a...
Jake Noga.
Yeah,
I believe who you're talking
yes,
about.
Yes, Jake Noga. He's a very key piece of that offensive line. And then also Jackson Wright, another guy up front. Great offensive line duo up there manning the middle. And you can see they kind of help clear a lane right there for, I believe that was Noah Jones, who's a sophomore running back. Really interesting player. Last season, Jared, only 86 rushes, but averaged over 5.3 yards a carry. Is extremely explosive as a freshman. I'm super excited to see what he's going to do now in his sophomore season.
See Andy Duplin go in motion from bottom to top. Connor back to pass, throws it out to, that is number three, Jimmy Nagel. And he is knocked down at about the 35, so about a gain of four. Tackle on the play by number 32, Alex Taylor, or maybe actually might have been 33, Max Conlin. It'll be second down and about six here, a minute into the game, and Alter positive plays the first two. Connor gonna hand it off and hit right at about the second level, maybe a gain of two on the play. And that was number 24 for the Knights again, Noah Jones. And I think we're going to call his name quite a bit tonight.
Yeah, like I said, only 86 total carries last season. I have a feeling he's probably going to be getting a heavy workload, probably around 20 carries a game. So he's gonna surpass that total pretty quickly in my eyes.
Feel the home side around starting to rock. It's third and three here for the Knights.
Quite literally.
You might be able to see it on the camera. Big third down here for the Knights.
A guy to watch right now.
And a timeout taken by the Knights.
A guy to watch right now for the Alter Knights when they really have to pick up, you know, a big third down. It's that big number five. You can see he's one of the last guys getting back to the huddle. That's Michael Russ, their leading wide receiver from last season, and actually their second leading tackler behind Reeve Schneider. A great two-way player. He gets it done on offense, on defense, and you know, he's a very tough player. Had 71 total tackles last year.
We remind you that tonight's game is brought to you by Minuteman Press of Kettering, where we design, print, and promote you. Coming out of the Alter timeout, third and three here. You see the rain starting to come down a little bit harder.
And we were talking about it on the field pregame, Jared. This is more like
a pitch, a tip of turnover, and Fairmont picks it up. Still a loose ball. The Firebirds pick it up to 10, 15. Touchdown for the Firebirds.
Big number 92, Matthew Labor. The second is the guy who got in the backfield, knocked it away. I didn't see who was the man to pick it up, but what a play there by the Firebirds. The rain starts coming down, and then things start coming down for the Alter Knights.
and like you said, we kind of talked pregame, how much is this weather going to affect? And that definitely affected that pitch. We talked about Connor, Daniel Seaton with that touchdown for the Firebirds. And we talked about Connor not having the biggest hands to be able to grip the ball fully and end up leading a turnover. And that's how the Firebirds scored first last year, was a defensive score. Field goal kick is up, and it is good, and the Firebirds strike first on a 20-yard return from Daniel Seaton off of a forced fumble.
And you know, Jared, that's another question that is there for the Firebirds this season. After 4 years of Will Holt, you know, kicking for them, being extremely efficient, hitting kicks that are deeper than most, you know, high school kickers would ever imagine to kick. He's been so efficient over the last 4 years. He's gone now. He's at UD, I believe, correct?
Yes, UD.
Yes, so congratulations to him and the Flyers for, you know, that relationship that's just getting started. But, yeah, you know, that a big question was how is the kicking game going to be? And so far, you know, the opening kickoff out of the back of the end zone.
And that extra point looked extra like it would have been good from about 40.
Looked pretty good, exactly. So.
So now if you're Alter in this offensive unit, you got to have short-term memory here. Don't let that turnover haunt you the rest of the game. Going to see how the Knights respond. Granted, last year, that touchdown that was blocked by the Firebirds, that was with about 20 seconds left in the half. So
field goal.
Or the field goal, yeah. 9:50 left in the game, or in the first quarter, is not where you want to be. Trying to see the number of the kicker, but Fairmont's jerseys are just so hard to read.
It might be an 18.
18? So that'll be Asa Dunleavy?
Maybe it's not an 18. Maybe is it 10?
Max Gehring. Yes. Okay. That does sound familiar. And Gehring puts that one in the end zone. And Alter going to start at the 20 again. And so far, three kicks. Gehring looks pretty good.
Yeah, that kick is received by Colin Wenner. He's a senior and he's a captain for this Alter Knights football team.
So the defensive unit for the Firebirds on that first drive showed out pretty good. Gave up, really the big play was that 11-yard run by Noah Jones on the opening handoff of the game. But other than that, two check downs at the receiver position. Now it's going to see how does Domsites and Connor dial it up here on their second drive. High snap, handoff to Jones. Jones gets to the edge, but hit right at the 20.
There's Daniel Seaton in there on the stop. Yet again, he was a man who just scooped and scored the touchdown coming up. Big tackle there. So needless to say that he's getting off to a very hot start this season.
Gain of nothing on the play.
One wide receiver set out to the top of your screen. Two backs, three backs.
That one's going to be a handoff to Jones and hit in the backfield immediately for about a loss of three. Tackled by number 68, Connor Haston. Third and about, oh, they're going to say he got to the line of scrimmage. Okay. Third and...
Well, and, you know, Jared, in a Dayton Daily News article before the game, I read that, you know, Coach Miller talked about the inexperience of this Firebirds team, and, you know, because they lost a lot of guys, five or six guys on both sides of the ball, and then, you know, they have a huge sophomore class.
Connor back to pass, throwing middle of the field, and it is intercepted by the Firebirds! And is that number one, Cameron Payne? Or is that... That might have been number 26, Stevie Doty.
Yes, sir. It's Stevie Doty right there. one of those veteran leaders that is still here from the last couple of years. But so anyways, yeah, Coach was wondering how this much younger group, much less experienced group was going to, you know, play and pan out here in the early going.
First four minutes, Coach, things are going well. Doesn't look inexperienced.
Force two turnovers, have the ball in positive and field position.
You've heard how quiet the Alter side has gotten. I mean, they were rowdy and loud before kickoff, but nothing to cheer for yet. Baker's going to keep this one for the first offensive play for the Firebirds. And a gain of about two on the play.
Get up to the 46-yard line.
That actually might have been Zach Gagel. See, the sun's starting to come out here at the north end of the end zone, but rain's still coming down.
Baker lined up under center. Barking out orders.
Play clock down to two. Handoff there. Gets across the 45 to about the 42. Turner with the carry there for the Firebirds.
That was a nice run there by Turner. It's hard to see where the ball was with
There's a lot of motion in the backfield.
There's a lot of motion, and our windows are a little cloudy right now.
Third and four. And if I'm Fairmont here, I would not be opposed to be taking a shot here. We know Miller gambles a lot and goes for it in fourth and short situations.
Carson Copley lined up to the bottom of the
screen. Baker's
going to
keep that one. Baker bursts through, gets across the 40.
And
ball comes out.
Extra push.
And Alter gets the turnover back.
And so the inclement weather playing a factor on both sides of the ball. Baker ends up coming away from the pile with the ball, but not quite sure who recovered that from the Knights.
Called by number 15, Colin Wiener, is what the PA announcer said for the Firebirds.
Last season, Colin Wiener had two interceptions and three fumble recoveries. He's picking up where he left off last season. Now a time for Alter to settle in, kind of regather themselves. One man split out up top.
Handoff goes up the middle.
That's number 12, Mikey Rose. I believe that's his first carry of the game. Gavin Kopic in on the stop.
Profit with the tackle there for the Firebirds.
Second and about six.
Halfway through the first quarter here. Alter under center, handoff. That looks like, is that number 26? Rod Owens.
He's going to spin out of a tackle and then get thrown down. He's out across the 45, out to the 48-yard line. So it looks like it'll be third and two. Still a steady rain here in Roush Stadium.
So third down here for the Knights. See if Alter keeps it on the ground here. Connor gonna go back. Connor keeps that one. Connor is stopped. I think he might be about a half a yard short.
Yeah, I don't think he got there. There was a host of Firebirds there. Matthew Lamberth, one of the Firebirds, number 92.
Fourth down for the Knights. Fourth and less than one. And
a tell you what, if you're Coach Miller, you got to be really happy about that. Turning the ball over, you know, in positive territory, you're able to not give up a single first down. So far, the Firebird defense been executing.
They're going to roll to the right, and this one's going to be a fake for the Knights. It has the first down. That is number 15, Colin Winner.
Colin Winner, a great returner, a great defender, a great
running back.
And a great kicker, I guess. Yeah, a great fake kicker. At least fake kicker.
Yeah, because he don't have – he listed a wide receiver in DB, so Alter gambles for it at midfield. And
last season, Sammy Miller and Tony R. Curry were the punters and kickers for the Knights. Looks like the rain is picking up a little bit more.
Connor hands it off. About a gain of 4 on the play.
That's Owens.
See the rain really coming down now.
You know, Jared, I'm glad we get to sit inside.
Yeah, I'm kind of glad we're using our production kit too for this and not having students out in the rain. Second and 4 for the Knights here. Loose ball.
And Gavin Connor just lucky to be able to get back on top of that. I believe he knocked the ball away from himself. The rain just coming down. And you said it earlier, Jared. He's not very big. So, you know, his hand size could be an issue. Sometimes it can be tough hanging on to that football.
So third and about 13 now. Here for the Knights. Connor back to pass. Two-step drop, throws it to the outside, and it is hauled in. And it is not a first down, though. And, well, that's going to be close. That's like right at it. And they might have call for a measurement.
That's Carter Sheets, number 1 there on the catch. Nice job of him finding the opening in the zone, sitting down and just waiting for his quarterback to deliver an accurate strike.
No, good job. Safe first down.
And a good job by Connor of, you know, not thinking about the last play. And, you know, the rain lightened up over the last 30 seconds. He was able to, you know, get a little clearer mind. Delivers a nice strike there.
Alter moving downfield on this drive. We approach 2 minutes left here in the
two
first
wide receivers
quarter.
Split out top. Two wide receivers split out to the bottom of your screen. Owens in the backfield.
Owens is going to get the carry. Owens tackled. Looked like that might be from behind. Was that number 92, Lambert or Lambert?
It's a combination of him and I believe maybe number 3, Toby
DeGlow.
DeGlow, okay. Yeah. Toby DeGlow, a 5'7 defensive back.
He is the younger brother of Jesse DeGlow, the Firebirds running back from about 5 and 6 years ago. Connor going to hand this one off. Trying to cut to the outside and tackle or goes nowhere. A lot of sideways motion there for, was that Owens?
And Logan Wilkins in on the stop, number 24 for the Firebirds. Nice job there. And you know, it might sound simple, but running north and south is a lot more effective than running east and west. And right now they're doing a lot of east and west and not a lot of north and south.
About 45 seconds left and counting here in the first half, or first quarter. Connor Connor back to pass, takes a step drop. Connor scrambles in the pocket, dumps it off, but hit immediately is that number eight, Andy Duplain?
Yes, sir. Nice job of Connor to find in the outlet. Andy Duplain running the drag route, but not much there on that one. Gonna make it fourth and nine.
And I would say if I'm Alter, I just let this one go.
And it looks like that's exactly what they're gonna do.
And that one is gonna do it to end the first quarter here in the Battle of Kettering. Fairmont up 7-0 after scoring on the first drive of Alter with a defensive scoop and score. They're going to switch sides, and Alter's going to have a 4th and 6 coming up. And as we break down, going into the rest of the game, Alter coming off of a 6-6 record last year, going 1-1 in the playoffs. Had dominating wins over Thurgood Marshall and Meadowdale. And then a couple nail-biters with Northwest out of Cincinnati. Carroll was an overtime game and a single score in the playoffs against Reading. And then the Firebirds coming in last year. Dominating wins over Alter, Trotwood, and Beaver Creek. And then we were here for that LaSalle game last year.
Big-time game against LaSalle. Very low scoring, but... You know, that kind of felt like a prove-it game for the Firebirds, you know, going and playing having a Cincinnati team come up here and getting a chance to knock them off.
And Alter looks like they're going to line up and go for it on 4th and 6. Not a lot of trust in a Curry. Connor going to roll to the right, rolls it, throws it down, and it is incomplete.
Through the hands of Carter Sheets, and that was a big-time drop there. He had the distance for the first down, just I think a combination of the weather, and maybe he just lost a little bit of concentration there as the defender closed in there.
So the Firebirds are going to take over here in the second quarter at the 27-yard line.
Carson Cope, please split out all by his lonesome.
Baker under center for the Firebirds, turns around, hands it off up the middle, and exploding through his number. Was that number 20?
21.
Justin Turner. Tackled by number 11.
Jared, this is going to be a lot different, you know, regardless of whether the Firebirds actually do start passing a lot more or whether, you know, they still run the ball like 99% of the time like they normally do. It's going to be a lot different this year just because, you know, their carries aren't going to exclusively go like 80% to one guy. You know, they don't have Drew Baker anymore and they don't have a guy like him, at least not that we know of right now. So... I feel like the carries are going to be split.
And off there goes.
A lot more than what we're used to seeing out of this Firebirds team.
Might be enough for a first down, and the chain gang's moving, so it is. First down for the Firebirds, their first down of the season. Baker looking at the sideline for instructions from Coach Miller. Baker gonna hand that one off and push forward for about another 4 or 5 yards is Justin Turner.
So Justin Turner being effective here in the early going of this game for 14 minutes.
The last two runs he's had, Alter's knocked him forward for about 7 or 8 yards total. But in you talked about that Dayton Daily News article about Miller talking about opening up. We've seen Alter have a couple mishaps with Connor dropping back to pass and put it on the field twice. Maybe with the rain and at least the wet field, maybe holding that off. And that one stopped immediately at the line of scrimmage. And Turner goes nowhere.
Jackson Neese, junior defensive end for the Knights, in on the stop. First time we've called his name tonight.
It's going to be third and four here for the Firebirds. 9.5 minutes left here in the first half. Brock hands it off. No, Brock pitches it out late to Cameron Payne. Payne gets to the edge. Payne first down across the 50 and knocked out of bounds at about the 45.
Huge carry there by Payne. Nice job to stretch it out, find the outside, and great patience by Brock Baker. Waited till the very last second to make that pitch.
Got that, I don't know if that
got,
was the
got
end.
The last defender to go and commit, makes the pitch last second, and then that opens up the whole left side of the field
and
for Cam Payne.
Was a penalty that we didn't see.
All
so
that excitement
for
nothing.
Spot foul. Only a loss of 3.
But that's going to negate the first down and make it a 3rd and 7. Wipes away the biggest offensive play of the game. It's time to try it all over again. Payne in motion. They're going to pitch it to him again.
Payne gets the pitch. He gets to the edge. Turns upfield across the 45, and it'll be about a yard, maybe a yard and a half short. And now some decision making here for the Firebirds.
And I think you're giving Alter a generous spot, Jared. I thought it was closer than that myself. I mean, from where I'm sitting, I think I'm sitting right on the first down line, and I thought it was closer to a yard, like a half yard maybe.
Well, it looked like they kind of reset the ball, and Fairmont at least lining up for it on fourth down here. You got 14 seconds left on the play clock. Maybe you're just trying to kill some clock. Maybe force Alter to take a timeout.
Where they put the ball down?
They put the tonnage in. Fairmont got the first down.
I was about to say where they put the ball down, they needed a whole yard, and they got at least 2.
Got almost to the 50. I didn't see who ran that. I believe it was Turner, because now I see Dunleavy and Gagel run onto the field. Now see, this is where we start to see that old Firebirds team. You get a drive going before the end of the half. That's why Fairmont, if they win, they always defer to the second half, to the kickoff. That's something that Bill Belichick has done forever, coaching with the Patriots, and Brock keeps that one. Maybe a gain of 1.
You get blown up there by the defense. Henry Riefschneider
in
there.
Called his name
number 34. I don't know if we've really been looking for him enough. Big number 34 standing there in the middle of the field. Just got the call from his sideline and now relaying it to his teammates. One guy split out up top for the Firebirds.
Rain has virtually stopped now. Play clock is down to 6, and that is going to be a false start penalty.
That might have been on Cam Payne. I'm not sure, but I think I saw him get started a little early there.
That's going to be second down and 14. Just over 7 minutes left here in the first half. And this might be where we might see one of those first passes of the year for the Firebirds.
Once again, Carson Copley all by himself to the bottom of the screen.
Brock faked the handoff. That one goes up across the 50. That was by number 48,
I believe.
Damon Patton, first time we've called his name tonight. And that is a gain of about 7.
effective run there. Nice job. Cut the, took care of the penalty yards. Got those back and a couple extra.
Third and seven here for the Firebirds. 6:20 left here in the first half. Payne goes in motion. Brock back to pass. Brock slips, and he is sacked back at midfield. And you saw Payne was coming across the middle, trying to cut back in to get back to the quarterback, but that slip by Brock might have cost him the time.
Well, and I think it cost him the time to throw and the time to escape because, you know, the defense got there quickly. But Brock, we know he's a very quick and an elusive player. I think if he wouldn't have slipped, he would have either had the time to throw that one or get out of the pocket and make something of that play.
I'm gonna have
but I think it's the first time I've ever seen four different Firebirds go out for a pass.
High snap. Low kick. Dropped in at about the... Oh, fielded at the five. And then knocked out of bounds at about... the 20, maybe? I did not see where he went out.
Colin Winner on the return. Nice job there by the senior returner slash defensive back. That ball would have been inside the five. Does a nice job picking it up. Makes one Firebird miss and gets it out to the 15-yard line.
I was kind of leery when he was went to pick that up. I was like, make you hold your breath for a second if you're Alter fans. But now... 5 minutes, 17 seconds left here. Two timeouts for the Knights to try to get something on the scoreboard before the half.
Three wide receivers to the top of the screen, one to the bottom, and the shotgun. Oh, and there's a fumble,
On the play. Fairmont picks it up. And inside the 10 are the Firebirds.
And that might have been Stevie Doty.
So Fairmont, three forced turnovers in this first half in the 56th Battle of Kettering.
It was number 24, Logan Wilkins, the man to force the or to pick up the ball on the fumble. So the Firebirds are going to be set up.
Goal to go situation. Oh, no, sorry, at the fifth.
No. I believe it's on the nine. They haven't updated the scoreboard yet.
Do we need to go over and do that too, Andy? They're messing us up. So, yeah, first and goal here at the nine for the Firebirds. And the way we've seen Garen kick, this is at least 3 points here for the Firebirds.
Yeah, that's for sure. We saw him knocking them through from 40, 45.
In warm-ups. Brock turns around. Brock
gonna
keeps
keep
that
it.
One. Brock dives forward at about the three and might get down to
get
the
down
two.
To the one. He's very close. The ball is placed on the one. And I think the Firebirds, they're going to go quickly here.
So there's a lot you can do here if you're the not, or if you're the Firebirds. You could have Brock just line up right under center and run. Turn around and maybe hand it to Turner. Play clock is down to 10. Brock barking out instructions at the line with play clock at 5.
Brock's finally set. 3 on the
Brock
clock.
Brock turns over. Brock runs it in. And Brock Baker in from 1 yard out for the Firebirds.
It's going to make it a 14-0 Fairmont lead. And you know, Jared, you told me that you were able to make it in to practice on Monday, and the coach was barking. The coach Miller was barking at the guys, saying that they're not going to give that Alter House any reason to cheer for the next year. And so far, they're holding true to that word. Defense forcing three turnovers. A lot of questions coming into the season about the inexperience of this team. They're answering all of them right now.
Kick is up and kick is good,
even from the kicking position.
Kicked
that almost over the band seating, like over the band's place.
He was trying to kick it through that window in that Alter House. So 14-0 lead the Firebirds here with 4:22 left here in the first half. Again, coming from our sponsor, Minuteman Press, we remind you, starting September 1st, they have their school spirit sale starting, a little online store they're working on. And they're going to offer, I think they were told me, about 4 or 5 different shirt colors for about each sport. So Firebirds fans watching, be sure to pay attention to Minuteman Press on social media to find out when that goes live and stock up on your Firebird gear.
I'm assuming that's where you guys got those Beat Alter shirts.
Yes.
I myself don't have one, but they are very nice.
Gearing out on the 40 to kick this one off.
Do you go for a fake? 4 minutes?
I don't know, Andy. That. I've seen Miller do it before to try to really get a stranglehold on the game, and believe me, he would try to keep off the ball for the rest of this half, and that just really tire out this Alter defense. Gehring boots this one deep, kind of rotating left and right, but again, middle of the end zone, and I guess if you don't want to return, you just let Gehring just go deep with it.
2 for 2 on the extra points, 3 for 3 on touchbacks.
And there it is, the band starting to file in now. We were wondering, we didn't get to see them script birds. That's kind of the tradition here. Always look forward to seeing that. But we'll see it next week in our game of the week for week number 2 as we're back here at Roush as the Firebirds will host the Trotwood Madison Rams.
I just didn't want to get hit by Garrick's extra point.
Yeah, well, they waited. Well, Fairmont will still score this way in the rest of this quarter, so they better watch out. Connor under center this time. Connor hands it off.
That is to number 12, Mikey Rose. His second carry of the game.
You know, we haven't really called Jones's name since those first two drives, I feel like.
He's had a couple of carries, but, okay. You know, they I'm not sure, man. Like, they really haven't been... They've been mixing it up with Rose, and then
Owens.
It was also, yeah, number 26, Rod Owens.
You see the sun really coming out now here.
Another guy whose name we really haven't called is Michael Russ, you know?
I know, I think... Well, no, the only time I remember calling his name, Connor's back to pass, throws it middle of the field. That bounced off the helmet of...
The tight end, or the...
No, that's Owens.
Yeah, that's
Owens.
Owens.
Yes.
It looked like he was lined up.
The only time they called Russ's name was that fake punt run that I remember. That's going to be 3rd and 5 here for the Knights. And you would assume a pass play coming here, maybe for the Firebirds, with how your safeties and corners have been playing, maybe bring a couple extra to add pressure to Connor.
Only one wide receiver split out.
Connor throws it to the outside, hauled in, but tackled immediately as number 1.
Sheets. Carter Sheets had a pretty nice first half so far. At least three receptions. Been an effective target, really the only effective target out there for the Knights. I think if they're going to be effective, they're going to have to get Andy Duplain more involved and Michael Russ, kind of like we've been talking about, a couple really important pieces to this offense.
Connor under center. Connor's going to fake the handoff to the initial back. Big hole to the outside, and that'll be a first down run. Is that Owens?
No, that is Noah Jones.
Or no, now we talk about Jones not getting his name called, and he gets the carry there.
2:55 left on the clock here in the first half. And the Alter Knights are in business. Picking up their second first down?
Yes.
Here on this drive.
On this drive on third down. And
now two wide receivers split out top, two to the bottom.
And see, this is where Connor can be more dangerous, is when he's solo in the backfield. He can tuck and run if he has to, but he's going to throw it out, and that is incomplete. And
that's out of the reach of Sheets.
He threw that way above Sheets.
Yeah, I'm not sure if Sheets could have caught that if he was 6'9", and he's actually 6'4". So that's pretty big.
That's a pretty big target. He's still overshot by about 4 or 5 yards over him. And I mean, looking at the lines, you would think Alter has the size advantage on the line advantage here on the offensive side. Connor back to pass.
But the Firebirds have done a great job getting penetration. He's going to tuck it and run, make it out across the 50, probably
about
to the 47.
Yard and a half short. 40. This one stops at the 46. Back judge. So it'll be third and about.
Oh, but Connor is limping his way back to the huddle, and it doesn't look pretty, man.
He looks like he's wrapped up high and hit, or wrapped up low, but hit high. A minute 50 left here in the first half, and you see Connor is limping, and this one might be a turnaround and handoff just so he doesn't try to have to put pressure. No, he's going to go back to pass. Third down. Connor hit as he threw, and it is caught by Russ.
And for the first time this game, Michael Russ coming in and making a huge catch. Goes up high with Cameron Payne. High points the ball, and he's able to beat the all-star defender. What a job
Connor
there.
Connor was close to being at the line of scrimmage when he let that one go. I didn't know if he was just going to run it because he was right at the line of scrimmage.
I didn't think he had the power to run it there. Nice floater pass there out to Noah Jones. He's going to have
Jones
the angle.
He's inside the five.
Is that going to be out of bounds? Looks like at the 2 yard line.
A minute 15 left and counting.
Great execution here over the last 3 minutes for the Knights, trying to get themselves back in this game before the end of the
Fairmont
first half.
Fairmont is going to take a timeout.
And their coaches are imploring. There's a couple of them jumping up and down, trying to get the attention of the refs. Finally do to get that timeout called. Coach Miller is going to pace his way out there. You see, he's kind of heated right now, not happy over the last couple of plays.
That'll leave both teams with two timeouts. Alter knocking on the door, trying to cut this deficit in half and get back. Or get to the, actually, sorry, that was a timeout taken by the Knights.
And you know, Jared, those plays, those little passes out to the flat can be so dangerous sometimes. You just start to get the defense spread out a little bit, and then if, you know, your elusive running back can just make one or two guys miss, then you can be in, then, you know, as a defense, you can be in real trouble.
And you saw, Seaton was there on the edge, and Connor kind of had to throw it at a weird angle to get around him.
I mean, it was a lob pass, that's for sure. I mean, he might have only thrown it like about 11 yards, but it was a high pass. He did everything he could to get that over top of the long arms of Seton. The snap,
handoff
up the middle.
And he gets in from a yard out.
I believe that's Rod Owens in there for the touchdown. Okay, looks like it's Mikey Rose.
Rose for the touchdown for the Knights. Cuts the deficit to 8, pending the extra point. A minute 12 left here in. Oh, here now we see a Curry kicking for the Knights.
Weird number for a kicker, number 95.
I know, that's.
I didn't think he'd be on the line.
That's a low snap, but it is good.
Cameron Payne almost able to get in there and
we
block
saw
that
he blocked two field goals and a punt last year. So he has the ability to get back there and do it.
Wasn't one of them in this game?
Yes, he blocked that field goal before half, and Doty was the one who picked it up and returned it 80 yards. A minute 10 left, and now they mess with the timeouts again. Back to two timeouts apiece for both teams. Two timeouts, a minute 10. Maybe depending on what kind of return the Firebirds get, maybe something to work with. I mean, we haven't seen Alter kick off yet, so I don't know if they're going to have a Curry kick or Russ.
I think it's our Curry. I can see him running out on the field right now.
Okay. But yeah, you're right. Number 95. Weird number for a place kicker.
And see, I was expecting, yeah, he's like a
he's 6'5", 6'2", 212. He can play deep, like you said, line. I can tell you what, I would not want him to be the one to try to tackle me. That
Pat McAfee size.
Right. And now the officials are stopping.
Timeout, Fairmont.
Fairmont taking a timeout on the kick. Maybe Miller saw something he didn't like. Or maybe saw something he did like and wanted to get it out there. You're probably going to have... I think I saw Payne back there. And...
it looks like they might be looking at him right now. One of the trainers kind of pulled him off to the side.
Yeah, Payne's not going back out there. So you're going to have number 26...
Stevie Doty,
and I think that was at least
45 or 43.
If it's 43, it's his younger brother, Logan Doty.
And if it's 45, it's Devin Porter.
Logan Doty. Oh, it is his brother. All right, brother's in the backfield. Alter kind of kicks that to the sideline. If I'm Fairmont, I would let that go out of bounds.
Cost yourself about 15 yards.
Yeah. Because it was going there.
Stevie Doty, not normally the guy who they go and to grab the kick, so.
Well, no, last year it was Baker and Payne, so you got to replace at least a little bit of size with Doty. So a minute 7 left here in the first half, a timeout for the Firebirds. The way the Fairmont's defense has been playing, you got to consider this a win for the Firebirds in the first half. Was 3 turnovers. I think the Alters put the ball on the ground 2 other times, but got it back.
One wide receiver split out to the top of the screen.
I believe that's Carson Copley at the top.
Yes, it is. Firebird's going to use this whole clock down to 5.
Brock's going to keep that one. Brock stays on his feet, upended at about the 30, falls forward to the 33.
Had a nice little opening to the outside, to the left. He's able to pick up, call it 7. And it looks like the Firebird's going to be content to take a 7-point lead into halftime, as they don't look like they're in much of a rush.
No, and getting the ball back to start the second half, I think I'd be fine with that too. You see Fairmont kind of lined up in their quarterback knee, 24 seconds between left in the half. Baker's gonna hand it off. Might have enough there for the first down. 17 seconds left.
I believe so. Yes, and they're moving the chains. Henry Reifschneider in on the stop. Starting to get a little more active here in this game.
Play clock has not started yet. 10 seconds left. Fairmont is going to be happy with taking this lead to the halftime. And that is going to do it for the first half of the Battle of Kettering in the MVCC Game of the Week 2023 opener. Fairmont leading 14-7 over the Alter Knights at the half. Stay tuned as we are going to, well, I don't know if the bands are going to perform or not with the field conditions. So if not, we will be back for the second half of our MVCC Game of the Week, presented by Minuteman Press of Kettering.
from the south end zone is the 2023 edition of the Cameron Fairmont High School Marching Firebirds. The 200-member band is the largest student organization on Fairmont's campus and is under the direction of Matthew Phillips and Brandon Schick, with assistance from color guard director Brandon Earhart and percussion director Tommy Williams. The Marching Firebirds are being led onto the field by Ruben Baker, Grace Oakley, Cabot Brownfield, and Delaney Sargent. And now, your Marching Firebirds. The Marching Firebirds perform a wide variety of music each and every season. The next tune will be familiar to your ears and was a huge hit for American singer Ava Max in 2020. This song is the fifth single from her debut studio album, Heaven and Hell, and it charted on the U.S. Billboard Hot 100 at number 13. We welcome the varsity cheerleaders, coached by Lindsay Farrell, to the field with their dance routine to Kings and Queens.
Thank you.
fall down. Next, the Mocky Firebirds and Varsity Cheerleaders.
All right, welcome back as we get ready for the second half of our MVCC Game of the Week kickoff of the 2023 season, brought to you by Minuteman Press of Kettering, where they are more than just paper. Andy, Alter trailing 14-7, had turnover issues there in the first half. What do you think they had to talk about at halftime?
Hang on to the darn football, man. Three turnovers in the first half, one of them inside their own 10-yard line. Can't afford that. I think the Firebirds got the ball back at the 9-yard line. That's where the Firebirds got one of their touchdowns. If you're the Knights, you got to be really excited. I mean, yeah, that sounds kind of crazy considering they're down 7. But like you said, three turnovers, it could be a lot more than 7. I think if you're the Knights, if you're the coach, you're just telling your team, you're just preaching ball security, and hey, we're right in this game.
Right.
We haven't been very effective on offense, but we had that one drive towards the end, able to get things going, cut the lead in half. I mean, it hasn't been pretty for the Knights, but things can be a lot worse.
Yeah, so, like we said, three turnovers, but Connor put the ball twice on the ground that he luckily recovered back early in that first half, too. And one of the bigger question marks for us is we really haven't seen that Fairmont offense yet. We saw, like you said, they had a 9-yard drive right there when Alter turned it over, and then they had the scoop and score on the other one, and the other one they went 3-and-out on that one possession.
Yeah, I think they've had the ball 2 or 3 other times, and they just, they haven't been able to sustain anything long distance so far.
Penalties have ended that for them.
I mean, they had a huge run by Cam Payne, midway through the first half. That got pulled back by, I'm not even sure what it was, but
I think it was
some
block
kind of a
flag.
Yeah, so, the Firebirds, they could be up a lot more than what they are. They've kind of hurt themselves in a couple of different situations, but, you can't be too upset when you got the lead. And
you get the ball here to start the second half.
I was just about to say.
We were talking about, right before we came back on air, I think this, if Miller wants to really take a hold of this game and kind of cement this in for the Firebirds, I think we're going to see one of those old school year 2, year 3 Miller drives where they try to take 7, 8, 9 minutes off the clock, as well as score in some sort of fashion, because even a field goal up 10 and you say you give the Alter the ball back with 3 minutes left in the third quarter, their shots are numbered if Fairmont can drive methodically down the field and still put points on the board.
Yeah, if the first time that the Knights touch the ball is with, like you said, 3 minutes left in the third quarter, then, if you're the Knights, things start getting tight. You start feeling like you're running out of opportunities, you're running out of chances. And so if you're the Knights, you gotta come out here, gotta get a 3-and-out, and gotta get the ball back, give your quarterback a shot to, get things on track.
And Tony Akuri kicks this one off, fielded at about the 20, across the 35 out to about the 36, 37 maybe.
Stevie Doty on the return. Nice job there by the veteran returner. And let's not forget, at the end or near the end of the first half, one of the trainers took a look at Cam Payne. So interested to see how his status is here for the second half. A very important player on both sides of the ball for this Firebirds team. Explosive offensive player and one of the most elite defensive corners in the entire state.
I see Brock under center here for the first drive of the second half for the Firebirds. Brock's going to fake the pitch. Brock looking downfield, throws it, and it is hauled in at the 44-yard line.
Looks like that's number 18,
Asa Dunleavy.
First time we've really called his name tonight, and we didn't see a lot of the passing in the first half. There, he's able to deliver a nice pass to Dunleavy. He's a little behind him. He had to turn around and pull that one in, but nice job there.
Hey, 1 for 1 on the year. That's all you got to worry about if you're the quarterback that, like we talked about, doesn't throw up much, but potentially maybe opening up a little bit this year. It feels good to get that first completion down of the season.
How many times did the Firebirds throw the ball last year?
16.
16 times, so.
And there's a carry up the middle. Big hole across the 50. Still on his feet at the 45.
And Firebirds 40. Still pushing.
And down inside the 40 with a huge run there for the Firebirds. And I believe that was Turner.
Big number 89, Luke Cheatwood for the Firebirds. Got on the back end of that pile and was pushing and pushing and pushing. Good job there by the big man. Listed as a defensive end slash tight end, 6'2", 205. Lots of power in that tall athletic frame.
Two plays and the Firebirds are in plus field territory here at the 40 of the Alter Knights.
Box completely loaded, 10 guys within 6 yards of the line of scrimmage.
Brock's gonna keep this one, get tackled at about the 30. Six.
I think they're going to mark it down at the 37. So a pickup of about 3. And we were talking about the Firebirds coming out with a long, with an extended drive. And Jared, it's been less than 2 minutes, and they're on the opposing 36-yard line.
That's why we're up in the booth, Andy. What we thought was going to happen doesn't.
I like the change, though.
Play clock's down to 7. Brock going to keep this one. Brock has a hold of the outside, lowers the shoulder, and goes over the defensive end there, and it'll be about a yard, maybe half a yard short.
You know, I think Brock kind of didn't do what that play was supposed to do. It looked like things were going to break it towards the right side. Brock,
he saw that there was a hole there.
Wasn't going on the right, and it broke out with a little hole to the left side.
Gain
nice
of
there.
5 on the play, 3rd and 2 here.
Taven Gifford, number 77, did a good job clearing the way for him along the offensive line there.
Now here comes the strong eye for the Firebirds. Handoff up the middle, and that one is going to be close. Looked like he had to get right to the 30.
And they're going to mark him down at the 31. So not enough. It's going to make it 4th and 1. And a very interesting decision here for Coach Miller. Do you go for it? 4th and 1? Or do you go and, you know, just try and tack on the extra 3 points? So far, the kicking has been pretty good. But this will be a much longer kick.
They're staying out there. Yeah, this will be about a 40. It'd be about a 45, 46-yard kick from here if they decided to go for it.
Strong eye, 3 guys lined up behind Brock Baker.
Play clock is at 8. Baker goes under center. Baker turns around, hands it off, and the first down for the Firebirds out to the 25.
Stevie Doe, or maybe not. That is Justin Turner.
Turner.
And so the young Turner showing his worth here in the first game of the season.
Baker looking back to the sideline for the call.
Stevie Doty split out wide to the bottom of your screen. Man in motion.
Brock's gonna keep this one, turns upfield. Brock can't evade the shoelace tackle there by number 11 for the Knights.
And I think Brock might have taken the wrong lane. Zach Gaggle, number 7, he surged up the middle of the right side of the defense there. I believe if Baker would have followed him, there would have been a bigger hole. But instead, I believe he got pulled down by number 11.
Okemdi Easy.
Thank you.
Yep.
Needed some help there.
Under 7.5 minutes left here in the third quarter. Brock back to pass. Brock checks it down middle of the field, hauled in at the 20, stays on his feet, gets down to the 15.
I believe that is once again Asa Dunleavy. It is second catch of the second half. Nice job there. Brock drops back, goes through, reads number 2, and then finds the check down. Asa Dunleavy, the drag route going across the middle.
2 for 2 on the year now, Andy.
Have we ever seen them throw it twice on one drive?
Ooh. On one drive? I don't know.
There's a first for everything, Jared.
And you talked about how they got to the plus side of the field with like less than 2 minutes of play clock. You see they've taken off about another 4 minutes as there's a run there by,
I believe, Baker on the keeper.
I'd say the window got foggy in my area where I was trying to. Oh, that's on the outside too, so that doesn't even help.
Speaking of the fog, the rain is gone. Things are starting to dry out. And I think that might be part of the reason we've seen a couple pass plays here on this first drive.
Definitely a strange weather for week one. We're used to 95 degrees at kickoff, a lot of timeouts for cramps and all that. Now it's like about middle of the week season and
it's 70 degrees out.
It doesn't feel like that up here with the wind and everything. It's like we're getting ready for pumpkin spice season. Brock hands that one off.
Though I did not see who to.
Walker by number 21.
Turner. Pickup of about maybe two on the play. Three. It'll be third down and four.
Number 28, Nolan Ogburn in on the stop for the Knights.
Third down, Fairmont.
Third and four from the 9 yard line here for the Firebirds. They can get the first down without the touchdown.
One man in the backfield, nobody split out. And Brock is gonna keep it, finds
Brock
a hole up the
one.
Middle. He's gonna surge and he's gonna get up to around the two, it looks like. Nice job by Baker. It looks like he was about to fake a pass or something like that. He decides to tuck it and finds a hole up the middle.
Gets down inside the two.
And you know, Jared, when you and I were talking about, you know, the difference that this Firebirds team would have before the season started, one of the things that you pointed out was the height of Brock Baker. We haven't really seen that from a Firebirds quarterback in a while. He's 6'2". He can actually see over the offensive line that allows him 6'4".
6'4".
Wow. Okay. He's a lot taller. He's actually able to see over the offensive line. It allows him to make better decisions.
Baker under center. Baker. Turns around, hands off to Turner, and Turner stopped immediately at the line of scrimmage. Right, we were talking about, I mean, the tallest quarterback the Firebirds have had
Ogburn
before Baker was probably 5'9", 5'10". So definitely, but that's almost 7-8 inches difference.
And yeah, we can just keep talking about the massive difference it makes. And you know, after Coach Miller told you that they'd likely throw the ball a couple more times, that was one of the main reasons that you brought up. You know, the ability to see down the field is so important.
Brock turns around.
He's going to give it to Turner, tries to bounce it outside, and he's not going to make it. Gets inside the one.
And with that run, that at least makes my prediction right that the Firebirds are going to take a 9-minute drive to start this half. Because the play clock, it'll be right at 3 minutes if they don't hike it before. Third and goal here from the one.
So it took them about 2 minutes to go 50 yards and then about 6 minutes to go 25.
Strong eye here in the backfield for the Firebirds. Baker under center. Baker gonna turn around, hand it off. And in for the score, Justin Turner with a 1 yard run, and the Firebirds go up 20-7 over the Alter Knights with 8 minutes, 50 seconds. They hiked the ball too soon.
When we talk to coach after the game, you can get on and I'm not taking all the time.
I needed
that
10 extra seconds. They hiked it with 16. Gearing on here to attempt his third extra point of the game.
Gaggle to hold.
Gearing is 3-for-3 on the game.
Great concentration there by Gearing, because it looked like Gaggle kind of mishandled the snap a little bit. He's able to stay focused and drill that kick through the middle of the uprights. Extend the lead to 14.
3:10 left here in the third quarter of our MVCC Game of the Week, presented by Minuteman Press of Kettering, where you build your business with Minuteman Press of Kettering. a 14-point lead, and we talked about the Knights, if they got it back under three, it's going to be hard for them to try to do anything. Not going to say it's not easy, but two scores down, and if you don't score in this drive, if you're the Knights, and you give Fairmont the ball back, and it's not still in this quarter, it's going to be a long fourth quarter for the Knights.
Yeah, down to your final 15 minutes of what many believe is the most important game of the season for these two teams.
I mean, no other school starts off with your biggest rival of the year. I mean, could you imagine if Ohio State and Michigan or Duke and North Carolina played the first week of the year?
It'd be no fun.
No. But this, the 56th Battle of Kettering.
This is different.
Yeah. School separated by 0.3 miles. Fairmont has won 4 of the last 5 meetings. Gehring boots this one. That one is going to the sideline, and he fields it at the 1.
Wenner looking for a hole, and there's none to be found, but he's going to get out to around the 24 or 25 yard line.
Tackled by Wilkins for the Firebirds. 3:03 left. Alter trailing by 14. Now, what do the Knights have to try to do on this drive, Andy? With this their first drive of the second half.
Well, Jared, you know, I think they're going to have to play up-tempo. You can't get away from the running game completely, but you're going to have to go up-tempo. Got to look for Michael Russ, Andy,
Duplain,
and then Noah Jones. You know, he was the guy that was able to score their touchdown, or he got them inside the 5-yard line with the little catch and run from the...
And that goes backwards. Gets across the 25
from the backfield, so they're gonna need some quick plays, and they definitely don't need that. A pickup of 1 on first down there.
On that last drive, Connor came up limping very badly for the Knights, going back to the huddle, and he stayed in the game and delivered that strike to get the touchdown. But we'll see how it affects him into the second half, especially for sitting so long.
He looks all right, and jogging his way back out there just now. So, like you said, we'll definitely have to see. It didn't look pretty in the first half. It hurt me looking at him.
Connor going to take it. Step back hit as he threw. That ball was almost intercepted by, who was that, number 40?
It's number 16.
That number 16? Skyler Slifer.
Sophomore, 6 foot, 190 pounds. The intended wide receiver was Rod Owens. Now Alter in a really tough situation.
The three and out is not what the Knights can do here.
Taking off less than a minute of clock so far. And yeah, they don't want to burn through clock, but
you don't want to give the ball back to the Firebirds. What would be probably decent starting field position. Connor back to pass. Connor looking to throw it down middle of the field, and it is hauled in at about the 47.
Michael Russ, he had a huge catch in the first half, has another huge one right there, and you know his big catch in the first half kind of jump-started that touchdown drive. Maybe we'll see that happen yet again here. He's able to pick up about 22 yards.
Yeah, they were just past the 23, just past the 25 out to the 48. Connor going to line up in shotgun formation.
Two wide receivers split out to each side.
Connor back to pass, throw quick out to the running back.
This time Fairmont it's Owens.
Comes open.
Going to cut back inside.
Gets across the 50, down to the other 48.
Pick up a 4, nice little outlet pass, able to pick up some quick yardage. Minute and a half left here in the third quarter.
I know you got to kind of float those out to the running backs out of the backfield like that, but looked like Connor put a lot of air under that to allow the Firebirds to come up defensively. As we approach a minute left here in the third quarter, Alter down two scores, trying to, like you said, go fast but not kill themselves momentumly. Connor, middle of the field, hauled in at the 35.
That's Carter Sheets. He's got another big catch. He was very active in the first half. A minute left here in the third quarter. Another first down for the Knights. They're in business right now.
50 seconds left and counting here for the Knights here in the third quarter as they are driving downfield quickly. Connor making adjustments.
Michael Russ split out to the bottom of your screen. Three wide receivers.
Connor looking that way, throws it inside, and it is incomplete. Looked too low.
Yeah, didn't put enough on that one. Russ was open. He had a slant. And, you know, I think he had one guy to beat, and he would have had a chance for a touchdown. But the low throw, Russ had to die for it and unable to make the catch.
Second and 10 at the 34 here for the Knights. 37.2 seconds left.
And, you know, we really haven't seen Connor miss on many of these throws. I mean, even the interception that he threw,
they both went up for it.
Yeah, the wide receiver was right there. The defender just made a better play.
Then there's going to be a flag that's going to be holding on the Firebirds.
More than likely, a huge catch there by Sheets, but that is likely to be negated. They're going to call a holding on the offense. I believe that was the left tackle. That one is kind of right out in front of us.
That's going to be a spot penalty. Oh my goodness, this is.
That one's
back
hurt.
Across the, almost back to the 45. Loss of about 9 on the play. It'll be second and 20.
Noah Marquez, number 71.
Connor throws it quick out to the outside. Wide receiver screen blocking a little bit downfield.
Russ is going to get inside the 40. He's going to pick up most of the penalty yards.
And it's going to be about third and
14.
And that one is probably going to do it for the quarter. As the time runs out, Fairmont going to go into the fourth quarter.
They're going to get up to the line and at least try. But not enough time.
So Fairmont going to go to the fourth quarter with a 21-7 lead. Here going into the fourth quarter of our MVCC game of the week, brought to you by Minuteman Press of Kettering. Kind of what we expected as we talked about planning throughout this week. It feels like it's a close game. Alter has a chance here to try to get it to a one-possession game, but Alter's defense is going to have to force a stop.
Yeah.
And probably a turnover if they really want to have a chance to get back into this.
Yeah, but, you know, week one, rivalry game, this is kind of what you want, Jared.
We remind you that the Spiritware shop is going to be coming soon for the Minuteman Press Kettering. You're going to get a chance to buy, I believe it's multiple different sports at about, I think they're offering 3 or 4 different color varieties. You're going to have your blue, navy, or your navy blue, white, silver, and I don't know the other color. They said they didn't tell me, so it'll be a surprise, and we'll definitely have to wait for that. I think they said it's September 1st is when that store opens up, so be on the lookout for Minuteman Press on Facebook, Instagram, and so, I guess we have to call it X now.
So third and 14.
Here's a pitch with Duplain, and Fairmont sniffed it out perfectly.
And out of all the play calls you could have made right there, I think that might have been the last one I would have called. I am not a big fan of trying a sweep on the biggest play of the game for your team so far. Now going to have to punt because there's no way you're going to go for a 4th and 16.
You would not think. Doty back to return the punt for the Firebirds. And here you see, that's kind of what. Doty picks it up and puts it back on the ground.
And number 34 Henry Reifschneider is the man to pick it up. Stevie Doty, a very experienced veteran player for this team, and the senior just makes an unthinkable mistake.
At that point, I think Fairmont and Miller would be happy. Let it go inside the 10. It gives us more yards and more time to try to take off the clock. But here you give Alter a goal-to-go situation.
Well, Jared, you knew it couldn't be easy, right?
It's never easy.
First down, Alter.
Two-possession game. 50 seconds into the fourth quarter. The handoff to Jones. He's going to get down to the five-yard line.
Ball carry by number 24.
The stop is A.J. Culbertson, who got up a little slow, but he looks to be all right. Showing some toughness out there.
Pick up a 6 on that play for the Knights.
Stepping down is Cole Holder from the Fairmont 5-yard line.
Jimmy Nagel split off to the top of the screen. Connor under center, 3 backs behind him. 1 splits out to the bottom.
Connor gonna go drop back to pass. Connor rolling to the left. Connor has it, flips it to the end zone for a touchdown.
That is Joe Dorley there for the touchdown. He's gonna cut it to a 1 possession game. A great job, the late release there on the route by Dorley. The defense never saw him. Connor does a great job extending the play, and after he executes a block, Dorley slips out of the backfield, and with the chance to cut the lead to 7. Tony R. Curry out there. The hold. The kick
is up, and it is good. 7-point lead now for the Firebirds. 10-19 left here in the fourth quarter. We saw what the Firebirds did on their last possession, and that was chew clock and score. And if you're a Firebirds fan watching, chewing clock is about as much as what you want to happen, and hopefully get into at least field goal range to go up 2 scores again. Start to feel the tide shifting a little bit. Alter getting a little bit of momentum after Fairmont. That was their second turnover.
You know, we're going to talk about it one more time. At least the inexperience of the Firebirds. This is a time where you know, the questions are going to be answered. Are they able to, you know, hang tough, hang on to this lead, and get out of, you know, the most important game of the season with a W? Or are they going to fold here in the final 10.5 minutes.
Looks like they brought out a different ball. Our Curry set here to kick off for the Knights. 10-19 left here in the fourth. Boots this one. Fielded at about the 21-yard line. Hole to the outside, stays on his feet. Doty gets pushed out of bounds.
Nice job there by Doty on the return, and you gotta love seeing a strong return there by him after, you know, he makes a mistake
after that
on the other
punt,
end.
And then you put him at about, what is this, the 42-yard line?
It looks like that's where they're gonna place it, at the 42.
So a return of about 22 yards on that for Doty. And now we're going to see how the Firebirds respond.
You know, something I had never seen before that I saw just now in the kickoff is one of the Alter players was facing the other goal, like their end zone. Like
yeah,
when they just kicked that off. That was interesting.
You see that a lot.
Big ball up the middle. Going to be out across the 45, looks to the 48-yard line for the Firebirds.
You see that a lot with teams that might struggle with offsides on kickoffs, so they just sit there to mark for the team when to actually go not to try to lead before the kicker gets the ball off.
Gotcha. All right. The 7-yard pickup on the first down run. Get it under 10 minutes remaining here in the fourth quarter.
Play clock under 5. Brock under center. Brock going to turn around. Keeps it with Turner, and he might get to the 50.
But no more, and he's going to be thrown back in the aftermath of that play.
So third, I think they're going to keep it. He might not have gained anything. Third and 2 here for the Firebirds. Play clock's under 15. Game clock under 9 minutes. Baker calling out directions at the line, goes under center.
10 in the box for the Knights.
Baker going to keep this one. Baker has the first down, cuts upfield. Baker at the 40, the 30. Baker inside the 25, down to about the 20.
He's going to be stopped by Okimedy, easy number 11 for the Knights. And that is exactly what the Knights say. That's exactly what the Knights needed.
A big run there on first or third and short for the Firebirds. And Baker.
First down and 10, Fairmont. From the altar 21, Fairmont.
21 yards between them and pay dirt. And with the clock running at about 8:15 left here in the game.
Carson Copley's going to split out wide. And you got to wonder if another one of those pass plays are coming.
Brock back to going to keep this one again. Brock has a hold of the outside. Brock inside the 10.
Reef Schneider is going to be the one to stop him this time. And
that's going to be another
one defender and one guy to beat. And he just wasn't quite able to beat the all-star middle linebacker there.
If you're Miller, I think he's fine with not beating him. Go down in the field of play. Let's take another 35, 40 seconds off this play clock and get closer.
And it's probably going to be more than 35, 40 seconds because it's probably going to take at least 2 more plays to get to the end zone.
Now you hear the student section starting to get into it.
Both student sections starting to get into it as the Knights defense trying to get a stop here.
Brock going to hand that one off to Turner. And he goes inside the 10 to about the 7.
Blown up by Reef Schneider. And he hasn't had the most active game, but I'm assuming here in the fourth quarter when the stars come out, he's going to have a bigger impact here.
Alter late substitution coming off. So we're under 7 minutes left now here for the Firebirds. Second and goal from the 8.
And this is what just makes it so hard coaching against Dave Miller, man. Like,
it's like you,
he just takes away all the opportunities. There's no room for mistakes against this Fairmont team because they just don't give you the ball enough.
I mean, there's a timeout on the field.
That one's going to be by Fairmont.
Timeout, Fairmont.
We're going to have 1 remaining. Looks like 2. Okay, so 2 remaining.
The scoreboard was quick with that one. 21-14, 6:37 left here in the game. Brought to you by Minuteman Press Kettering. They definitely came on board for a great game in the 56th Battle of Kettering. And Fairmont, like you said, Fairmont, they did a huge order of these Beat Alter shirts. And so far it's coming through. And just imagine how much more and what cooler designs you're going to have when you got football and band and both basketballs and the spirit wear shop coming out for the Minuteman Press Kettering crew.
We'll see. I'm assuming they sell out of those Beat Alter shirts every year, right?
Just about, I would say. 6:38 left here in the fourth quarter. 2nd and 8 for the Firebirds in the goal-to-go situation.
Yeah, so a couple of years ago, I went up to an Ohio State Duke game to catch Coach K's coaching a game in his final season, and it was the Ohio State Michigan week, and all across campus. They have every M on every sign, on every anything crossed out. It's the same type of thing here with Alter and Fairmont. There's going to be a stop by the Knights. It looks like John Kylie is going to be the guy in on the stop. But yeah, I was walking around before the game. I saw Beat Alter written on the ground multiple different places with the A's crossed out.
Oh, yeah.
The hate, the malice goes just as deep here as it does up north.
Wait till week 9 when we're at Centerville and you walk around here and all the C's are going to be crossed out. It is a hatred rivalry. 3rd and 8 here from the 8-yard line. Under 6 minutes left. Play clock is down to 9.
Copley split out.
Brock pitches it back out to Gaggle. Gaggle gets to the outside and he is tackled in play. But inside, it looked like he might have got down to the 7.
John Kylie in there again for back-to-back stops. I guess it's pronounced Keeley. John Keeley.
So here we go. Max Gehring on to attempt his first field goal. And this is going to be about a 25-yarder here for the junior.
3 for 3 from extra point.
Kick is up, and the kick is through the uprights and good.
And 1 for 1 on field goals. And the pressure that made kick is going to put on the Knights is just, it just takes it to another level, Jared.
Yeah, I mean, 10-point game is a lot different than a 7-point game with just over 5 minutes left.
And sure, you have all 3 timeouts, but, you know.
That's a score, either an onside kick or a turnover, and then another quick score. And Alter's running out of time.
Well, especially with a Fairmont offense that seems to have found a second dimension, you know. They're not throwing the ball a ton, but a little bit more. It adds a little bit, you know, a little bit more guessing for the defense. Makes it harder to defend. Man, if you need one stop, it's just going to make your whole team think, oh, but what about that one guy? It's going to make it so much harder to stop a team like Fairmont. So physical. Michael Russ and Colin Wenner back to receive the kick. Two extremely dangerous Knights. They're going to need a couple more plays out of each of them, I would think, if Alter's going to have a chance to come back here. Just over 5 minutes remaining.
I don't think Gehring has given Alter a chance to return on any kickoff. This one fielded or kicked into the back of the end zone.
About 2/3 deep into the end zone. So yet another great kick by the new kicker.
.509 left here in the game. Alter got to get going downfield in a hurry. Going to be led by junior quarterback. Sorry. Gavin Connor, see if he has some late game magic to try to get this to a 1-score game and make it a little bit more interesting.
3 wide receivers split out to the bottom and 1 to the top.
Connor going to roll to the right. Connor going to stop, plant, throw middle of the field, and it is incomplete, but a flag comes in late.
Flag, and I don't like it. The intended target was Carter Sheets. And maybe they're going to call it a hit on a defenseless receiver? I'm not quite sure, because I don't think the defense got there early.
They're going to call it pass interference.
Well, according to the refs, the defense did get there early. But nice job there of Alter moving the pocket. They're able to buy Connor a little bit of extra time. Able to deliver a nice pass down the middle.
Connor going to roll to the right again. And Connor brought down in the backfield for a loss of about two on the play. I did not see who got there.
I said number 45.
Devin Porter for the Firebirds getting there, big, getting the sack.
Big time sack. It's going to force him back 2 yards. And most importantly, it's just going to
keep that clock
ticking.
Connor back to pass. Connor looking to, surveying downfield, and it is tipped and incomplete. I think that was intended to Nagel, wasn't it? Nagel.
Gavin Prophet in to knock the ball away.
And third and 12 here for the Knights. 4.5 minutes left. Alter taking some time to maybe try to get this going. Coming onto the field with 13 seconds left on the play clock.
And they're going to have to hurry to get this thing off.
Play
five.
Clock is at five.
I don't know
Three,
if they're going to have time.
3, 2, 1. Alter barely gets it off.
Connor, he's going to have to move. Throws it out. He's going to find Jones. And he's Noah Jones is going to pick up a big time first down there. Third and 12. He's able to convert that. Keep this game alive for the Knights. At least for another couple minutes. Great job there by the quarterback, able to scramble and find his running back coming out of the backfield. They're gonna reset quickly.
Jones going quickly, throws the middle of the field, incomplete.
Out of the reach of Michael Russ. Second and 10, 4:12 left here in the game.
Alter at the 47-yard line, second and 10 here.
53 yards to pay dirt.
Connor in shotgun formation. Connor gonna take a two-step drop back, dumps it off to the running back out of the backfield, and he is plowed over. Jones.
Gonna get it across the 50, out to the 48, pick up of about five.
Under 4 minutes left though here. Knights gotta hurry up, third and five.
It looks like they said he got out of bounds, so exactly 4 minutes on the clock.
Connor looking to step up in the pocket, throws the middle of the field.
And Michael Russ over the middle, big time play. He's been making them all second half long. That one's gonna get the Firebirds, excuse me, the Knights into Firebird territory. They're going to be inside the 25.
First and 10 at the 23. Alter approaching 3.5 minutes left. Jones going to roll to the right. Jones evades one sack. Jones stays with it, throws it middle of the field, and swatted away in the back of the end zone.
And Connor almost made what would have been the throw of the season, and I get it, it's the first game of the season. But Michael Russ had a chance to pull that one in with one hand. What a play. I think he might have been past the line of scrimmage, Jared.
See, that was close. And
very
I think,
close.
I think the refs are talking about that. They're going to put 320. Oh, well, our clock is
324,
wrong.
So about 3 seconds back on the clock.
325 left on the clock.
Wow, that last play was almost huge, Jared. Three wide
second
receivers split out to the bottom, one up top.
Connor takes a two-step drop. Connor looks one way, throws the middle of the field, and it is hauled in for a first down.
Is that Russ? Yes, it is. He's got to have at least 5 or 6 catches here in this second half. But the clock will keep ticking. 3:10 on the clock.
At the 12.
Once again, three wide receivers on the bottom of the screen, one up top. Jones in the backfield. He's going to take the handoffs right up the middle, across the 5. He's still going, and it's going to be close. He's going to be down inside the 2, maybe at the 1. Noah Jones kept those legs churning. It's going to stop the clock temporarily so they can reset the chains.
First and goal at the one for the Knights.
Two wide receivers to each side.
Connor Jones in the backfield. Connor changing something at the line. Connor steps back. Connor going to hand it off to Jones. Connor kept it.
And he's not going to make it.
He might have lost a yard on that.
Gavin Profit gets in the backfield for the huge stop. And the Knights are going to take a timeout. And now things are really going to tighten up for the Knights as they needed that timeout. They either needed to score on that play or they needed the timeout. The running clock, they really can't afford.
If you're Alter here, I know you want to get the 7, but you need a touchdown and a field goal. Do you potentially just kick the field goal here and maybe give your team the ball back at least? Because if you run another play and Fairmont stops you from getting in again, that's at least another 15, 20 seconds coming off the clock. You take the field goal here, you cut it to one possession, and then you can kick it deep, and maybe Fairmont fumbles it or something, but at least you have the Firebirds with a long field to go.
And I think that might be a smart decision, Jared, but we will see what they do. They're going to line up to try and score. So Michael Russ lined up to the bottom of the screen all by himself. They're going to give it. It looks like to Mikey Rose, and I think he gets in. And yes, Mikey Rose is going to be able to get across the goal line and score his second touchdown of the game.
2:20 left and counting. Arcuri on to cut this to a field goal game. Kick is up, and it is good. And it is a one-score game once again. 2:20 left here in the 56th Battle of Kettering. Fairmont looking to get the ball back and just hoping to drive this out and get a win against your biggest rival, Week 1.
But Jared, through the wind and through the rain, this game has been phenomenal from start to finish. The first half wasn't the most action, but there was a lot of turnovers, kept things interesting. The second half, the scoring has picked up, and things have really tightened up here in the fourth quarter.
Remind you, 2:20 left, Minuteman Press coming on late, where they designed to promote you. Reminder, the Spiritware shop coming open September 1st. So we remind you, watch out for that. 1st of September, that's about two and a half weeks away. And start stocking up on your Firebirds gear from Minuteman Press. 2:20 left here. If you're the Knights, and do you try to, I mean, is there any chance that you think they might not necessarily onside, but squib it? No, they're going to go for the onside. And it's a loose ball. Controlled by the Firebirds, though.
Wow, that was dangerous, Jared. I believe it might have been number 78, and I'm going to need your help on that one.
Jonathan Gwizdak.
There you go, Jonathan Gwizdak. I believe he was the guy who was able to jump on that thing. I think it was either him or Gordon Gates. 78 or 79. The huge recovery right there, as the ball was active for a little longer than most Firebird fans would have been comfortable with.
They're going to make us sweat it out here the last 2:17 left. Alter, you would assume, is going to call the timeouts quick.
Carson Copley lined up at the bottom of your screen.
Brock under center. Brock going to hand it off to Turner up the middle. Turner bursts through.
Predator!
Turner with a big first down run.
Out to the 40-yard line. John Keeley, the man to make the stop for the Knights. But that just made things a heck of a lot harder for Alter.
Alter calls their second timeout of the game.
Picks up a first down.
2:11 left. Alter, one timeout left. Fairmont, just a big first down run there. Flips the field position. And Fairmont is really, in essence, two snaps away from really putting this game on ice.
Yeah, especially if they're able to pick up another first down. I mean, one more first down. This thing is completely over.
But you just get Alter to call their last timeout, and then Fairmont a knee or two away from starting the season 1-0 again for the fifth time, as they would beat the Knights the fifth time. No, this will be Miller's sixth time beating the Alter Knights.
Gotta wonder if Colin Winter or Henry Reef Schneider gonna come up here, make a big play. Two of their star defensive players had big nights so far. Dude, they got a couple more big stops in them.
Brock hands off up the middle. And Alter's gonna call a timeout quickly. And hold on, there might, well, no, there's no flag on the field.
I think the fans just got a little excited. There was a little extra pushing after the play, and
Alter calls their last timeout.
And so, you know, Jared, we've talked about it all night long, how youth and inexperience was a thing, was a theme for Fairmont coming into the game. One of the things is that last season, I guess I didn't count last season, but I know for a fact that Fairmont had like 10 guys on the roster that were all 6'4 or taller. This year, I think they got two or three guys that are of that size.
Mm.
So, you know, the trenches aren't quite as big as what we're used to, but they still got the push that we're used to seeing over the last, how long has Miller been here?
Since 2016.
There you go. So over the last, 7 years, we've seen great push from the trenches. We're still seeing it tonight, even though big guys aren't quite as big as what we're always used to seeing.
Fairmont taking every possible second out of that timeout.
You see one of the captains of the team, big number 74, Colton Green, 300-pound center, really anchors this Blue Hog unit, the pride of the Firebirds.
And Fairmont's going to leave themselves with one timeout left. They've taken a timeout. I think the play clock might have been down. No sense in getting a penalty here. 2:06 left. Wind down, starting to try to make our player of the game selection. There's a couple that you could think of. .206 left here in the game. Fairmont, one timeout left. Alter, none.
So let's see. Turner had one of the touchdowns, right?
Was Turner had one. Brock had one. And a defensive score. Brock going to hand that one off to Turner up the middle. Going to get to about the 35, maybe the 30, or 36, maybe the 35.
You can't forget about Matthew Lambreth. He was the guy who had the initial deflection, which caused the defensive score. He's had a couple big defensive plays. Real all-round effort here by the Firebirds tonight.
Yeah, Max Gary, 3-for-3 on extra points. A 35, 36-yard field goal, I think it was?
Something like that.
A lot of options here as we wind down, under a minute and a half left. Baker going to keep this one. Baker bursts through. Baker might have the first down.
And it is going to be very close. And they're saying to move the chains.
And that one is going to put a fork in it. First down run there by Brock Baker. The clock is moving, the chains are set, and Fairmont is about one or two snaps away from starting 1-0 for the, I want to get this correct,
the Firebirds.
They haven't lost since 19 to the Knights. Didn't play in 2020, but they've won every game since. So that's five in a row.
They're going to go into the victory formation. As you can hear the student section chanting, "Let's go Fairmont," as the Firebirds have claimed the first of the Battle of Ketterings for the school season, and the most important, many would think. Most, I would say.
Brock gonna line up in victory formation.
And you can see the Knight student section slowly starting to file out.
I don't know what the refs are doing. They're pointing at something on the clock or something. I don't know.
Is it possible these are Fairmont refs and they're just trying to keep Alter here a little longer to rub it in?
I don't know. No, they're not supposed to be from this region. Okay, now the clock was at 104. They moved it back down to 101.
Now they're talking with
Coach Miller. Now they put it back to 106. I cannot go back in and change our clock. They're going to go all the way back to 111.
Sounds like they're also going to reset the play clock. I believe I heard him say they're going to try and set the play clock to 7.
You've got to be able to move the play clock and just type in 7 on it.
Instead of just letting it count. All right, so the clock is now at 7.
Now the ref's going to call everybody out. We're going to start it. Play clock's running. Game clock's running. Fairmont takes the one knee.
And they're going to have to do that one more time.
One more time here coming for the Firebirds. One more knee. As they will... You're going to let this one go. About a 20-second difference between game clock and play clock.
And we've talked about it all night long, Jared. All the questions that Firebird fans had coming into this season.
I think they can put those questions away a little bit.
They answered a lot of them here tonight. And
that final knee is going to do it. Fairmont is victorious in the 56th Battle of Kettering. A 24-21 victory for the Firebirds. And you see the celebration pile out onto the field. And I don't disagree with naming Brock Baker the player of the game. He kind of put the game on ice with that big third down run.
All right then, sounds good.
Brock Baker will be your player of the game. And our MVCC game of the week, week number one bonus. Fairmont wins 24-21 over the Alter Knights. Signing off for Andy Horton and Jared Bergstrom in the booth. We will see you tomorrow night down at Holland Field as the Miamisburg Vikings take on the West Carrollton Pirates. Thank you again to Minuteman Press Kettering for stepping on, being our sponsor again. Look out for their Spiritwear shop coming live September 1st. And we will see you next week as we will be back here as the Charlton Madison Rams will take on the Fairmont Firebirds in week number 2.
That's all, folks.